Are you a buyer looking to take advantage of the real estate market this year and potentially purchase a property, but wondering what you can do to help your offer stand out amongst the competition, especially in multiple offer situations? Well, that's what we're going to dive into today. But before we get into it, my name is Jeb Smith. I'm a real estate broker here in Southern California. I want to thank you for taking the time to watch. If you're new to my channel, it's all about real estate, helping buyers, sellers, and homeowners navigate the real estate process. So do me a favor and hit that subscribe button if you're into all things real estate, and give me a thumbs up at the end if you like the content. If you've been watching my videos of the last couple of weeks, you've heard me speak about buyer demand. In fact, last week I mentioned that an article came out that said buyer demand was up 13% year over year. Now, a lot of people think that's crazy based on what we currently just went through with the pandemic and states being closed, you know, unemployment being at record highs, so on and so forth. But the reality is that buyers are out there to buy property, and a lot of it has to do with low rates. So if you're in one of those positions, like I'm seeing a lot of my buyers in at the moment, and that's a multiple offer position, what can you do to help your offer stand out amongst the competition? Now, for purposes of this video, I'm going to assume that you've already put the most amount of money that you can put down. So I'm not going to tell you to, you know, increase your price to help your offer stand out. So we're just going to assume that if you're an FHA buyer and you're putting 3.5% down, that's the best you can do. Or if you're putting 20% down, that's the best you can do. What we are going to do is talk about some things that you actually can control outside of the down payment. The first thing you can do as a buyer to help your offer stand out amongst the competition is a buyer letter. I tell every single buyer that I'm working with to write a letter about themselves, about their family, what they love about the home, to attach the offer that I plan on sending over to the buyer's agent or the listing agent. And the reason I do this is because, you know, most sellers want to know who's buying their property. A lot of times they've raised their family there, they've been there for a long period of time, and they want somebody like them, in a lot of cases, to take over the family home that they've raised their kids in. And so, you know, in my experience, it helps. It helps draw emotion out of the seller. It takes it from a transaction of buying and selling a home to an emotional thing where the seller is actually involved now. They want to, you know, they want their family to go to a good family. And so by writing that letter and drawing out that emotion, it helps your offer stand out. And all the time I get buyers coming to me going, I really should do that. That's what I should do. And we write the letter, and then we get the response from the agent on the other side saying how much that letter meant to the seller, how the seller, you know, took that letter to heart, and it helped our offer stand out amongst the competition. So number one would be write that buyer letter. Even if you don't think it will work, it can't hurt. The second thing you can do is waive contingencies or shorten your contingency time frame. Now, I'll be the first to tell you, I never recommend waiving contingencies completely when buying a property. And you might be saying, what is a contingency? Well, when you purchase a property, at least in the state of California, you have 6 different contingencies when buying that property. Some of those contingencies include appraisal. That means that, you know, you have the right to get an appraisal on the property. If the value doesn't come in at the purchase price that you're purchasing, then you don't have to buy that property. That's a contingency. The second would be a loan, right? Loan approval. So the loan, if your loan doesn't get approved, you can use that contingency to back out of the contract. You also have a home inspection. Again, you're doing a home inspection on the property. If there's something that comes up in the inspection that you don't like or that you're requesting to get fixed by the seller and they don't agree to do it, you can use that contingency to back out of the property. Some of the other contingencies include seller disclosures. So you're going to review the seller disclosures on the property. You're going to review the title report on the property. And if the property has a homeowners association, you're going to get homeowners association documents as well. And you have the opportunity to review them, at which point something in there you don't like, you can back out. So waiving all your contingencies would basically put your deposit at risk. So your earnest money deposit, when you buy a property, you're putting that earnest money deposit down as a good faith to show that, you know, you're a real buyer. And when you waive contingencies, essentially you're giving the rights to that escrow deposit away. So that's why I never tell buyers you should waive all contingencies. In fact, I never do that. But what you can do is you can shorten the contingency timeframes in the actual purchase contract to make your offer look more attractive. And what I mean by that is, you know, I keep referencing California because I don't know other states, but in California, you have 17 days to do all your inspection contingencies, and you have 21 days to have your loan approved. So what you can do on the shortening side is you can take that 21 days and maybe lower it to 17 days, assuming your lender thinks they can get your loan approved within that 17-day period. And you can take the inspection contingencies of 17 days and shorten them down to somewhere around 10 days. That's typically what I do with most buyers, just to help your offer stand out, because what it does is it gets you through that contingency period quicker, which is typically when most buyers will fall out of escrow. And so once you get through that contingency period and all contingencies are released, typically, you know, most buyers end up closing on the property unless something crazy happens at the end. So I would say 99% of the time, once you get past that contingency period, deals end up closing. So the quicker you can get through those contingencies, the better, you know, the better the seller is, because maybe they're in a position where they have to buy something else, and the more attractive your offer looks. Now, the third thing you can do is shorten your escrow period, shorten the time frame of which you're writing the contract and when you're trying to close. So typically, at least here in the state of California, deals that we see are normally somewhere between a 30 and a 60 day escrow period. And now, you know, how you can make your offer look a little bit more attractive is shortening that time frame under 30 days, maybe going 21 days or 25 days. But one thing you have to make sure of is that the lender doing your loan can actually close within that time frame. And that's a conversation that your realtor can have with your lender up front, and it's also one you can have with your lender when you're going through that approval process. Now, we're going to assume for purposes of this video, you've already been pre-approved, you've already provided all that necessary documentation to your lender, and you know they're in a position that all they need is that purchase contract for you to go into escrow to take all of that and submit it into underwriting. And at which point they can have an approval within a, you know, X amount of days. So what I will tell you is that most of my lenders can close a loan, assuming you have all of that documentation up front and ready to go, somewhere between 21 and 25 days. Some lenders can do it quicker. Some, like banks, typically want at least 30 days to get it done. And now, while you might say, well, what's the big deal between 25 and 30 days? Well, it's not a huge difference, but what I will tell you is if there's 5 offers, 10 offers, whatever it is, 2 offers, and they look very similar with regards to purchase price, down payment, all of that stuff, but one has a shortened escrow period versus the other, that offer is going to stand out. Even if the seller isn't interested in closing sooner, that offer stands out because, you know, this buyer said that they could close earlier, which in a lot of sellers' eyes makes it seem like a stronger offer for whatever reason. Now, you know, what I tell buyers is to go in with your best foot forward, and if the seller wants a longer time frame, then let them counter it back to you. But don't go in with the longer time frame up front hoping that they'll just accept it or that they'll counter you back at a shorter time frame. I say go in with your best foot forward and let them counter you back at a longer period if they so choose, because again, it helps your offer stand out initially if you're put up against another offer. The fourth thing I would say is put in a large deposit if you're able to. Now, I'm not saying you should put any more than 3%. 3% being on the high side is what I think you should put down as a deposit, but if you're able to do that 3%, then I say put it down. Why? Because it helps your offer stand out. If you've got 2 offers side by side, they both have similar purchase price amounts, they both have similar loan terms, but one has a larger deposit than the other, sellers generally look at the one with the larger deposit as a better offer, even though that money doesn't go to the seller until or unless contingencies are released and the deal falls out of escrow, at which point it still has to be agreed upon for that money to go to the seller. So that money is never the seller's money unless you release all the contingencies on the property. But in a seller's eyes, when they see one property that has, say, $50,000 and one that has $30,000, they look at the one with $50,000 as a better loan amount because of that deposit, even though that money's not their money. And lastly, and probably my best tip, is the escalation clause. Now, this is typically going to be used in a multiple offer situation. In fact, there's no reason to use it otherwise, but you're going to use the escalation clause in order to help your offer stand out amongst the competition. Now, you might be asking, what is an escalation clause? Well, I'm actually going to link to a video here above where I talk about it in more detail. But an escalation clause is something that allows you to go above and beyond any other offer out there without knowing where the offers are going to end up. And in this example, I'm going to use the amount of $1,000, but you can use whatever amount that you deem fit at that time or whatever your agent recommends. And that is in the case, let's say we have a property that's at $630,000 is the purchase price. We get a counter offer back asking us to submit our highest and best offer. We know there's other offers on the table. An escalation clause would allow us to put an offer in something like this, that the purchase price to be $1,000 higher than your highest offer up to whatever amount. But we need proof of the highest offer in writing or what have you. So basically what that would do is it would take our escalation clause and we would end up $1,000 higher than the highest offer at the end of the day. So say the highest offer in this case was $650, then that would automatically push us to 651. Now, you might say, well, that could go up to any amount. I'm not willing to do that. Well, you can put a cap on it, right? So you could say in this case, $1,000 higher than the highest offer up to 650,000. So if they received an offer at say 651, then your offer would no longer escalate because you capped yourself out at 650 and then that 651 would be the highest offer. So that in itself allows you to negotiate and go above the highest offer up to X amount. But keep in mind, if you've got two people using that same escalation clause and neither put a limit on it, you know, it keeps escalating. So there's got to be a line in the sand somewhere where you say, I'm not willing to pay more than X. And now keep in mind, even if your offer gets accepted, you don't have to necessarily proceed with that property, right? You can back out, but it's a way to actually get your foot in the door and get your offer accepted if you're willing to play ball like that. Now, what I mean is that you could say I'm willing to pay $1,000 higher than the highest offer, like I mentioned, and say the highest offer was 660, your offer would be 661. Now, that doesn't mean that the seller still has to accept your offer. It just means that your price is going to be higher than any of the other offers. And at the end of the day, most sellers are looking for price more so than anything else. Now, all the other things I mentioned will help your offer get accepted, but it all comes down to price. So if you can at least be in the ball game with price and then you have all the other things I mentioned, chances are you're going to win that negotiation because you've put your best foot forward in all those other places. But just because you have the highest offer doesn't necessarily mean it will get accepted. But in this case, you win it at $671,000. Assuming they accept your offer, the seller could come back or the seller's agent could come back to you and say, your offer was accepted, this is the price, this is proof of the other offer, and you could go, you know what, I'm not willing to pay that much and back out. But that at least gets you in the door or got you an opportunity, an at bat, if you will, to actually get that property and move forward with it. Where in the other case, if you just put in your offer, you would have never known where the price ended up and probably not had a chance. So I hope all of those things are helpful. I know there's a lot of information there and a lot of it depends on the situation that you're in, but make sure whenever you're working, putting in an offer, you're working with a professional, you're working with someone that knows how to guide you through that process, to talk about all these things that I just mentioned and can help you understand them, right? If an agent's just telling you to write an offer and submit it and not asking you to write a buyer letter, not asking you or telling you ways that your offer can stand out, if you're asking that question, if you know you're in a multiple offer situation, then make sure you're talking to other agents or interviewing with other agents, assuming you're not locked in with that one. So anyway, I hope that information is helpful. I know it's a lot of information. I appreciate you taking the time to watch. And again, if you have topics you want me to do in video, comment below. If you have questions about any of the information I did here, you can also comment below on that as well. But as always, I appreciate you taking the time to watch. I appreciate your support and I look forward to seeing you again soon. Have an awesome day. Bye-bye.